Secretary of Education, and I am here today to talk to you about education reform. In March of 2010, the United States Department of Education released a blueprint for reform, the reauthorization of the Elementary and Secondary Education Act. There have been many reauthorizations over the years to ESEA, and the Obama administration wants you to know what we value in education. There are five key priorities that we bring to you in our blueprint for reform. We want students to graduate high school, ready for college and a career, regardless of their background or disability status. We want great teachers and leaders in every school. We want there to be equity and opportunity for all students. We want to raise the bar and reward excellence. And we want to promote innovation and continuous improvement. We will discuss each of these areas in more detail throughout our video. We hope that you will leave us today with a better understanding of the direction we want education in the United States. Thank you.
I saw that there's this new blueprint for reform, and inside it says that one of its goals is for students that are graduating high school to be ready for college and careers. But aren't schools already supposed to be doing that?
Yes, many schools are preparing students for college and a career after high school graduation. However, about 4 out of every 10 college freshmen are having to take remedial classes in English and math. The aim of this goal, to prepare students for a college and a career, is to create standards in every state that prepares our students for life after high school.
Okay, so how will we know if our students are actually meeting these standards of college and career, or college and career?
Yeah, so there are different statewide assessments that are aligned with these state standards, and they will be used to measure whether the students are meeting the standards. These assessments are also being used to hold the state, the district, the school, and the teachers accountable for teaching these standards.
Okay, so what happens if the schools aren't doing well with teaching these new standards?
So for the lowest performing schools, there are 4 different types of turnaround models to help get schools back on the right track. They involve different levels of receiving more funding to bring in better administrators and teachers, while also providing better resources for the school. On the opposite end of this, schools that aren't reaching the new standards are eligible for rewards. The states will receive funds to give in competitive grants to these schools. They will also be able to create and participate in communities of practice, where schools will be able to share what is working well for them.
Wow. Well, thank you so much for helping me understand what these new standards are.
Yes, no problem. If you have any other questions, feel free to ask.
What is being done by the school district to ensure that my kids are being educated by effective teachers?
This new reform is designed to develop, measure, and improve the effectiveness of educators in order to provide equitable education. New policies are being placed in the school systems to ensure that both teacher and administration are highly qualified. Greater levels of preparation programs are in place for teachers and principals, and meaningful evaluations have been developed to ensure that such effectiveness is being practiced in schools.
How will this be measured?
Every 2 years, states and districts will publish report cards that include information such as teacher-principal qualifications, designation of effectiveness, collected surveys by educators on school support and conditions, retention rates, and teacher-principal preparation programs.
What is the school going to base their criteria on for finding these transformational leaders?
Well, principals and administration should be able to provide a track record of ensuring autonomy over staffing, budget, instructional programming, and schedules. They possess the ability to improve the outcomes of low-performing schools and student academic achievements.
Thanks for taking this time to answer my question.
Of course.
My child does not have a disability, but does not speak English very well. What will be provided to my student so that he is not placed in the special education?
We understand your concern. Schools now provide many programs for students who are English language learners, such as sheltered English immersion, dual language programs, and transitional bilingual education, for instance. Your child will take a state's English language proficiency assessment and be considered for the previously mentioned services.
Me and my family were new to this country, and I'm very afraid of how my child will do because of this transition. What can the school do to help?
Well, there are funds targeted toward facilitating and strengthening the transition of migrant students to both school and their community.
Okay, but how are these funds going to pay for such support and accommodations in such a rural place?
Eligible schools, such as this one, are able to receive funds under the Rural and Low-Income Schools Programs. It's also known as RLIS, and they're going to use federal education funds to adhere to improving low-performing districts.
Okay, thank you so much for that.
You're welcome.
Today I will be discussing the importance of a complete education. For our literacy programs, I will support the transition to higher standards by assisting states in strengthening their literacy programs and by providing support to high-need districts in implementing high-quality literacy instruction. I will strengthen STEM programs and provide support to high-quality instruction in at least mathematics or science, and may also include technology or engineering. I will ensure a well-rounded education by giving grants to states, high-need districts, and nonprofit partners to strengthen the teaching and learning of the arts, foreign languages, history, civics, financial literacy, environmental education, and other subjects. In order to ensure college pathways and accelerated learning, we will provide grants to states, districts, and nonprofit partners to increase access to accelerated learning opportunities for students. I will set funds to carry out additional activities to improve teaching and learning in academic subjects. I will give new grants to support the development and implementation of a continuum of effective community services, strong family supports, and education reforms. I will redesign and expand the school day or year, provide full-service community schools, or provide services before school, after school, or during summer. I will promote students' physical and mental health and well-being, nutrition education, healthy eating, and physical fitness.
Hi, Mrs. Apple. I want to thank you for sitting down with me and talking to me about ESEA reform.
Of course, it's no problem.
So, is there anything in this latest reform that really sticks out to you positively or negatively?
I'm very passionate about I-3, which is investing in innovation. This reform will build off of the original I-3 program.
Specifically, what kind of innovation is being invested in?
Well, schools will get grants to help them create innovative, evidence-based practices, programs, and strategies that are extremely beneficial to student performance.
Okay, very cool. Could you tell me some more about the grants that are being offered to charter schools?
Yes, my school, Southwest Baltimore Charter, has just applied for this grant. It is awarded to high-performing charter schools looking to expand.
How is performance determined?
From what I have read, it's based on past success and funding, supporting, authorizing, and managing the school itself, along with overall commitment to improving the quality of the school.
Mrs. Apple, do you know of any other priorities that the government is looking for with this reform, other than increased performance?
I believe that they have 5 priorities that they are looking to see in all areas of education reform. They are technology, evidence, efficiency, supporting English language learners, and students with disabilities, and supporting rural and other high-need areas.
That is really great to know. I really appreciate your time, and I should have this article written in about 3 days.
That sounds great. I look so forward to reading it.